All right. Good morning. Will y'all stand up and join us for worship?
You come set your root and reign, and in our hearts again, increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we were made, and come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our every soul. And Holy Spirit, come invade us now. But we and are your church, and we need your power and in us.
Come on, put your hands together.
We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst, and refuse to waste our lives for your joy and prize. And to see the captives' hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace. We lay down our lives for heaven's cause. But we and are your church, and we and pray revive in this earth. Build your kingdom here, and let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand, and heal our streets. Yeah, let us set your church on fire. Win this nation back, change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here, we pray. Unleash your kingdom's power, and reach the near and far. And no force of hell can stop your beauty changing hearts. And you made us for much more than this. Awake the kingdom seed in us, fill us with the strength and love of Christ. And we and are your church, and we and are the hope and honor. Kingdom here, let the darkness flee. Show your mighty hand, chill our streets. Yeah, let us set your church on fire. Win this nation back, change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here.
Church,
but we and are your church, and we and pray revive in this earth. And build your kingdom here, and let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand and heal our streets. Yeah, set your church on fire. Win this nation back, change the atmosphere. Build your kingdom here, we pray.
Amen, y'all give him some praise.
So glad you're here. I'm so excited about this first Sunday of the year. What a marvelous opportunity God has given us to worship Him in spirit and in truth. Well, you may be seated. I'm so glad you're here. Let me tell you, I just witnessed something a few moments ago that might be the very first time in my ministry I've ever seen this. I noticed earlier, just a few minutes ago, we were running out of space up here on the very front row. folks were trying to decide who's going to say, oh my goodness, we're out of spaces right here. And it's like, wow, that's a good issue. I'm glad it was solved. As I can see, they have forsaken you now. Nonetheless, I believe they're still somewhere on campus. Well, if you're a first-time guest here today, let me say thank you for being here. Congregation, would you join me in granting our first-time guest a welcome home? As a first-time guest, let me invite you to please pick up a yellow Connect card, fill that out. As soon as you've got that completed, you hold on to that, and then you'll be able to exchange it at the end of today's service as though it's money. We're going to give you a great first-time guest gift that is composed of some home-baked, oh, wow, treats made by the Futrell family, Nutella brownies, and Hershey peanut butter brownies. I've already had one church member this morning trying to disguise himself as a first-time guest, asking about that pizza coupon. So yes, as a first-time guest, please understand that you'll also, when you trade this in, get a coupon for a free large pizza, as well as a cup full of goodies to remember us by. But we believe today that if you are a first-time guest, well, you might have come as a guest, but we know that by the time you leave here today, you will leave as a friend. And you're going to be like part of the family. And let me just explain to you, family meets here every Sunday. So we look forward to seeing you the next Sunday. Today, let me just invite you to be a part of what you see on the board that's flickering. Next Sunday night, that's January the 12th at 5 p.m., you're all encouraged to attend to be a part of what will be our membership review meeting, where I'm going to be able to inform the membership of some exciting things. But everybody that's here today, I'm giving you a special invitation to be a part of that meeting, because it's not just that stuff. I'm also going to be casting some vision and sharing with you some very positive things and make some good announcements for the coming year and the coming decade of Harvest Christian Center. I'm excited about that meeting. But now it's time to worship the Lord with tithes and offerings. Pastor Debbie.
What a beautiful morning to give to the Lord. Can you say amen to that? Let's read our scriptures together. Amen. Give, and it will be given to you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be put into your bosom. For with the same measure that you use, it will be measured back to you. That's Luke 6 and 38. Praise the Lord. Father, we thank you, God, that all that we give to you, Lord, doesn't just remain, God, but Lord, you continually bless us, Lord. You pour out your blessings upon blessing, Lord, to your people. We thank you, God, for what you are going to do, Lord, with our offerings and our tithes, God, as you grow our church, Lord, as you grow our hearts and you grow our ministries, Lord. We give you praise and glory now, God, in Jesus' name. And everybody say it. Amen.
Amen. Once I pass you, you can stand up and continue to join us in worship.
Will burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. So open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the front gates, the mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our prayer.
Put your hands together.
Your presence in this place, your glory on our face. We're looking to the sky, descending like a cloud. You're singing with us now, Lord, unveil our eyes.
You're the reason.
You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. So open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, the mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of my praise.
Sing that again.
So open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, the mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our praise. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory. Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory.
Sing it out.
Show us your glory. Show
us, declare that.
Show us your glory.
One more time.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. And hating the dark, I I want to see dry bones living again. See me as one. Hallelujah. Holy, holy God Almighty, the great I am. And who is worthy and none beside me, God Almighty, the great I am.
Can I sing that again?
And hallelujah, holy, holy God Almighty, the great I am. Who is worthy? None beside me, God Almighty, the great I am. The great I am. The great I am. The mountains shake before him, the demons run and flee. At the mention of the name, King of Majesty, there is no power in hell or any who can stand before the power and the presence of the great I am. 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 The great I am.
The great I am.
worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one I could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. You're holy and holy. There is no one like. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Every song we could ever sing, and worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, and worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh Jesus. And Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one I could ever save. And worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. You're holy and holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up. Thank you.
Seats.
That's just for the record, in case you were wondering. Makes me feel better about the sermon anyway. But today we begin with that decade that is known as the 60s. Now, some of you lived through that decade. Some of you were teenagers and you have some good memories of that decade. And before I ever get too far into this message, I want to share something with you that was relayed to me by a couple of the saints of God as I've quizzed them about the 60s. What they want us to know and realize is that the 60s were not all bad, and everybody wasn't a hippie. Everybody wasn't inhaling, and everybody wasn't protesting. They want you to know that the 60s were filled with a whole lot of good, regular, Jesus-loving people who were just getting up every day, going to work, and going to church on Sunday, and doing the best they could to raise their family in the fear of God. That's what some people want you to know. I would even have you to know that about the current decade in which you're entering into and the decade that we just left. Everybody ain't like, you know, going to hell in a handbasket. There actually is a remnant of believers in the Lord Jesus Christ that are doing right and that are living for the Lord. But let's talk about the 60s for a little bit. If you go back just a little bit further, you find the 50s. And in the 50s, it was the doo-wop era. If you like music, it was a time of innocence. But that innocence had to concede in the 60s and take a backseat to social activism. In the 60s, there was just something strange in the air. You weren't sure if you really wanted to breathe in or not. You could hear it talked about, and you could see it on the streets. If you were privileged to have a television, you saw it. You might have been seeing it in black and white, but you saw it. What was going on? People were lining up all across our nation protesting. Everybody had a different cause. And if you didn't have a cause and you were just a little bit angry, how you had to do is just let somebody you know was angry and they'd help you find a cause that you could help protest. There was always a protest against something. But these protests kind of changed the face of our nation. The music culture began to reflect that mind shift, and then a couple of individuals from across the pond got together. Their names were John Lennon and Paul McCartney, and they wrote this song, and it says, "So, you say you want a revolution. Well, you know, we all want to change the world. We all want to change the world. Well, one thing's for certain about the 60s, whether you like it or you dislike it, I have to tell you, it is a decade that forever changed the face of our nation. Why do you say that? Because the 60s were like so weird, man. Everybody was revolting. Everybody felt like they were free. Some people actually thought that the 60s was the dawning of the age of Aquarius. But then I'm kind of like with the Beach Boys on this one who sung in 66, God Only Knows. But the 60s changed our world. It was all about civil rights. It was all about women's rights. It was all about the right to protest against the man, you know, whoever the man was, he was wrong, because they were against the man. And it was all about those anti-war protests. Some of you maybe even remember some of the posters that said, make love, not war. That was a characteristic sign. The key word of the decade of the 60s is revolution. And they were revolting against everything that was popular, all the standards, all the conventional knowledge that the church had did what it could to try to impress upon our nation to be a godly nation. The decade of the 60s was revolting against all of it. Therefore, even when they talked about war, this got reflected in one of the songs of the day. Somebody said, huh, what is it good for? The music of the 60s was wild. You just got to admit it. And then, of course, television began to follow suit. The 60s weren't all bad, but there are some bad things from the 60s. One of the revolutions of the 60s is known as the sexual revolution, and it was bad, my friend. We're still feeling and reeling from the damaging effects of the sexual revolution. This sermon is not about that, but I will tell you that from that point on, there has been a militant agenda that's tried to push down upon the church and make us accept and think that adultery and homosexuality and pornography are okay, and we should just close our mouth and close our eyes and just say, that's okay, everybody live how you want to. That was bad, my friend. I'll leave that alone, though. Because there was also a great revolution that came out of the 60s, and it's known as the Civil Rights Revolution. In the civil rights movement, one of the highlights of that movement took place in the 60s. In the Summer Olympics of 1968, there was a group of individuals who were really just irate about the systematic racism that was taking place not only in America, but all around our world. And in those Summer Olympics in Mexico, you find that there are two men who have won medals in those Olympics. But as they're standing on the stand and they're about to receive their medals, when the U.S. national anthem is played, they raise their hands as a form of protest. What's going on there? They realized that there's potential when you stand up for what's right, in spite of everybody else accepting it as being okay. I need to tell you, you and I have power in our hands as well if we would just realize the potential and the purpose of what God has placed in our hands. I want to take you to God's Word today, because that's where every good sermon should start. Exodus chapter 4 is where we're taking our reading. And I want to talk to you about a man who discovered that God had placed some wonderful power in his hands. He just had to get his perspective adjusted so he'd see what God had placed in his hands. In Exodus chapter 4, of course, I'm talking about the man that's named Moses. Moses discovers in this sanctifying encounter with El Shaddai that he has got a revolutionary potential in his hands and that God wants to use him to start a revolution. Exodus chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. Then Moses answered and said, "But suppose they will not believe me or listen to my voice. Suppose they say the Lord has not appeared to you." So the Lord said to him, "What is that in your hand?" He said, "A rod." And he said, "Cast it on the ground." So he cast it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from it. That's what you're supposed to do when you see a snake. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Reach out your hand and take it by the tail." And he reached out his hand and caught it, and it became a rod in his hand, that they may believe that the Lord God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. Moses' encounter with God actually starts a little bit earlier at the beginning of that third chapter of Exodus, as Moses is just doing what any good man of God is supposed to do. He got up that day and he went to work. And while he's at work, he begins to have an encounter with God. Something strange happens to him. As he's out tending the livestock, doing his duty, doing what he's supposed to do, he understands that there is a voice coming from a bush that's on fire. It's a burning bush experience, except for, here's the deal, the summers in that desert would get so hot that spontaneous combustion was no like extraordinary thing. It's kind of ordinary thing. But what typically would happen is if there was an act of spontaneous combustion for some dried out bushes, they would burn up. But you see, this bush was burning, but the bush was not consumed with the fire. Instead, it was an angelic appearance of the voice of God himself, and God's voice is coming from this bush. If you ever wondered how in the world did Moses have the aptitude, the strength, and the wherewithal to stay in the battle and do what God had called him to do, you have to go back to the burning bush experience. It's then and it's there that he comes face to face with the holiness of God Almighty and understand there is a power that's greater than every other power on the face of this earth, and he has called me, he's sanctified me, and he's got a purpose for my life. Now, even though Moses is having an experience with El Shaddai, God Almighty, he still maintains some reservations. He still has a little bit of self-doubt. Can I get a witness in the house of God? Some of y'all know God's called you to do stuff. God's told you to make a difference, and God's given you some direction to do this or that or another thing. Each of us has got different purposes in our life, but yet we still have some reservations. Oh, God, is that really you? Lord, what if people don't believe that it's really you that's called me? What if they think this is just all of me? And therefore, Moses goes to having this encounter, and he asks the Lord, verse 11 of chapter 3, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" But God said, "I will be with you." Listen to me, New Covenant believer. The Lord Jesus Christ has made this same promise to you. The same power of God, the same presence of God that was with Moses as he stood before Pharaoh and said, "Let my people go," is the same power and presence of God that will be with you when you go to fulfill the call of God upon your life. He said, "I will be with you." Yet Moses was still afraid because he said, "Well, what about your people?" Because he knew the children of Israel. I mean, he knew them to be a bunch of knuckleheads, always doubting something. He said, "What if the people of Israel, what if this great nation, what if they say to me, we don't believe you. If God really told you to do this, then what's his name?" Here's an identity crisis. I'm not really sure who I am. I'm not really sure if it's you that's talking to me, if I'm really called to do this. And matter of fact, I'm not even really exactly sure if I can explain to everybody I know who you are. God solves the identity crisis. I promise you, for every doubt, for every fear you have, God has a solution. God told Moses, he said, "Tell them this, I am who I am." It's very simple. We complicate matters with our fears and doubts and insecurities, but it's very simple. God says, you just say, "I am has sent me to you." Identity crisis solved. What you talking about, preacher? You see the reality about the call of God upon our lives, the call of God upon Moses, the potential that's in our hands. Friend, it's not about who I am. It's about who he is. It's not about my identity, but his identity. I'm never enough. I'm never going to feel like I'm worthy, but feelings are a liar, and God is always speaking the truth to me. It's not about who I am. It's about whose I am. It's about the I am. You see, the foundations, the basis for you to be able to start the revolution in your life and in your community, community and family that God wants you to start is for you to get a realization of who God really is. When you get your life built upon this experience with God and you get to know the great I am, you'll be able to conquer mountains. You'll be able to do exactly what God's called you to do because you'll say, "Hey, I got something in my hands that God has placed in my hands. And if he's with me and if he's the one that sent me, then I can do whatever God says I can do." Let me tell you about the four R's of how to start a revolution. You say you want a revolution, but you need to learn the four R's. Now, if you're older than I am, you understand the three R's of an education. There's reading, there's writing, and there's... Okay, some of you actually know that. Read, write, and arithmetic. And that ain't even how you spell it, but that's just kind of told the three R's of education. But here's the deal. There's some R's that are involved with the word revolution. First of all, if we look to Moses in our text, we see that he had to recognize something. God asked Moses this question. He says, "What's that you have in your hand?" You see, God was getting ready to show Moses that he had incredible potential already in his hands. But Moses had to get his perspective adjusted. Sometimes we describe it in our vernacular as an attitude adjustment. Anybody ever had the wrong attitude? It's okay. God can straighten that out. You either humble yourself in the presence of the great I am, or he'll let life and its circumstances humble you. One way or the other, though, God knows how to adjust your attitude. But God asked Moses, "What's that you have in your hand?" Well, if you're God, you should know. "This is just a staff. It's just my rod. This is what I poke at them sheep with. This is, you know, if they get too rowdy, I'll take the hook on this end and I'll rope them back in. This is what I use to take care of the livestock." God says, "What's that you have in your hand?" You see, you think it's just an ordinary tool. Moses could have said, "God, there's nothing. It's just a stick. It grew out of a tree, and I carved it with this hook on it so that I could help take care of these crazy livestock." But God says it's something more. You see, in your hands, you've discounted what you have. You would think that if God's really going to call a man to leave the desert and go into the courtroom of Pharaoh and stand before this great ruler of Egypt and all the known world at that time, that God would equip him and empower him with luxurious resources at his disposal. But all Moses has is a staff or a rod. But you see, what you already have is what God already needs. You got to grab a hold of this. Stop discounting yourself and what you... God knows what you got because God gave you what you got. Okay? Maybe what you've got is what God wants to use. Recognize your potential to serve God. God knows who you are. Listen, God knows how stupid we could be when He called us. I take great comfort in this when I look back over my life and I see what I have and what I lack. God already knew all that stuff. God knew that I had the potential to really mess some stuff up at times. Yeah, but yet He still called me. When God called me, He didn't interview me. He didn't have to have me turn in my resume or fill out an application because God already knew all the dirty details about my past. God knew there were some times when I really blew it. If you really understand the life of Moses, the first 80 years of this man, then you understand Moses wasn't always perfect. Moses blew it sometime. But what's that you have in your hand? Oh, it's just a staff. And so as soon as you recognize your potential, you're ready to move forward. The second R of this revolution that God wants you to be able to start is this. You've got to release your gifts to activate God's purpose. God told Moses after he asked him the question, what's that you got in your hand? God said, throw it on the ground. Or in other words, let it go. Release it. You see, this is a release activated response. You think what you got's ordinary, but as soon as you yield it and you let it go and you place it at the disposal of Almighty God, El Shaddai, He says, I can use that. Let me show you my power to take the ordinary and make it extraordinary. Always had been nothing but an ordinary, simple stick in His hand, but as soon as He releases it to the power of God before it even hits the ground, it's turned into a snake, a serpent, a cobra is what I believe it was. Kind of a fearful thing. But you see, you have to release your gifts in order to activate the purpose of God in your life. You got potential. Somebody's got to believe this. You got to grab a hold of this today. Turn to your neighbor and tell them. It's one of them uncomfortable messages. You got to turn to somebody and actually speak. You got potential. Tell them. You've got potential. Church, I need you to stop discounting the potential that God's placed in your life. You've got the potential to do so much more, but you got to let loose. You got to let it go. You got to drop it. Let loose. Stop thinking less of yourself than what God has already said about you. At this point in the conversation with El Shaddai, I would expect that Moses, the man of God, will be through making excuses, will be tired of trying to argue with somebody who already knows everything about him. At this point, he understands, I ain't just talking to a bush, I'm talking to God. I'm talking to the unseen God, the builder and maker of everything that is in existence. But yet, he's still got some doubts. But what he's got to do, even in the midst of your doubts, your fears, and your insecurities, I'm telling you, release what God's given to you. Sometimes that's going to be physical. Most of the times it's going to be a spiritual thing whereby in prayer to God, everything I have is yours. Everything I am and everything I ain't, God, I place it at your disposal for you to use me and do whatever you want to do with me. I promise you, if you pray that risky prayer, God will take you up on it and He will use you to change the course of His kingdom in this earth. Glory to His name. Well, what's that you have in your hand? And you find out that God takes what He has in His hand. He takes the ordinary with this release, activated response, and the ordinary becomes extraordinary. You see, what God wants to do with Moses is something that's wild, man. I mean, you're taking the guy who was like the original man on the run, who was like guilty for wrongdoing, and he fled Egypt. But now you're trying to say that you want this exile, you want this fugitive. God, do you know who you're talking about? This is Moses. Moses is, they're already familiar with who Moses is. They're going to recognize him. But God wants to use him anyway. Who better to use? God knows every detail of your life. Some of you think I'm just talking about those who are going to do what we would think of as earth-shattering things, exploits for the kingdom of God. I'm talking about every one of us. There is a call of God upon every Christian in this house. God wants to use you. God wants to use you to do great things. You see, the call of God upon Moses' life is not just take care of livestock. Taking care of livestock was just what he was doing to make a living, okay? That's what he was doing to sustain his family. And sometimes you got to do what you got to do to sustain your family and take care of what you're supposed to do. But understand, there's a greater purpose behind what you're doing than what you're doing. You see, the call of God that's beyond all of this, that transcends every dutiful detail of Moses' life, is that God is going to use him to be a deliverer for the children of Israel who are stuck in Egyptian bondage. God also wants to use you to help deliver the people around you. If you know that you've been set free, you've had an encounter with Almighty God, and you've heard His voice in your life, friend, you need to understand something. God wants to use you to help others find freedom. Nobody that you know should be willingly and ignorantly and blindly living in the bondage of sin any longer. They need to do that in spite of the fact that you've witnessed to them and you've talked to them and you've tried to tell them, hey man, there's a better way. There's forgiveness. You can have reconciliation. You can get right with God. And you don't have to live there any longer. You can find a new place. Egypt don't have to be your home for the rest of your life. You can leave Egypt and you can go to Canaan. Glory to God. Because Canaan is that place where milk and honey flows. Canaan is that place symbolically, spiritually, where you and I are who are in Christ and Christ is in us. It's a land where milk and honey flows. Well, Moses is having one more experience with God. He recognizes his potential. Now he understands he's got to release his gifts into God's hands. But now, you understand that there's something significant with what God does with this staff. It becomes a snake, a serpent. I believe it turned into a cobra. Why do I believe that? Because God doesn't waste details. You see, the ancient Egyptians were a pantheistic culture. What I mean by that is they worshipped a multitude of gods with a little g. But Moses worshipped the one and only true God of Israel, the same God that you and I worship, the God of his forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, something significant about the culture of the ancient Egyptians in that lower part of Egypt, where God was calling Moses to go back to, they love to worship a goddess whose primary symbol was that of a serpent. And upon all the pharaohs and those in leadership of his court, they worshiped this symbol as though it was God. They would have snakes, serpents like bronze of them on their headpieces that they would wear. The pharaohs would. And so it represents all the power and the authority of the kingdom that was holding God's people in bondage. But understand that God is about to do something as he shows this symbol of the world's power and authority to Moses. You see, God's about to tell Moses to do something I think I would struggle with. God's about to tell Moses, you see that, now you pick it up. Can I just tell you something in a manner of full transparency? I've got a background in holiness, and I'm Pentecostal in all my doctrine. But I do not handle snakes. I would advise you against handling snakes. I really would. As a matter of fact, I'm kind of like with Moses on this deal. The Bible says it turned into a snake. Did y'all read this in the scripture I just read to you, Exodus 4? And Moses don't jump over that detail. What did Doughboy do? He ran. Well, snake! Am I right or am I right? Ain't that what y'all have done? I mean, there's a few people who actually think snakes are cool. God bless your heart. Got pet snakes. You pet the snake and you hold the snake and you take pictures and put it on social media. And I'm sitting at home praying for you and keeping on scrolling. Woo! I ain't handling. I've got to remember now, I'm not from the 60s. I was born in the early 70s. And if you were born in the early 70s, you might have heard an individual by the name of Jim Stafford sing something like this. I don't like spiders and snakes. And that ain't what it takes to love me. That ain't my love language, okay? Reptiles, snakes, spiders, that ain't my love language. You know, that ain't, you don't do that for me and expect that I'm going to have a warm, fuzzy feeling. Oh, I really appreciate you. No, hold up. I'm too busy running. And the Bible tells me that Moses here, it says he fled. Moses was running. But I think just before that Moses is about to break in an all-out sprint that the voice of God got his attention. Whoa, 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 whoa. And you know, God is able to speak to us in a manner that nobody else can understand, but you'll understand and you'll recognize who's speaking to you. And all of a sudden, Moses had to stop. Listen to me. You need to recognize the voice of God and respond by listening to his voice. Not a trick question. You recognize what this is, don't you? This is a Bible. most days of your life, if you want to hear the voice of God, you need to get in this book. I understand there is a modern day office of the prophet, and you can get a prophetic word from this Pentecostal minister and this charismatic leader, but the reality is they don't live with you. And if you really want to hear the voice of the Holy Spirit, open up this book and hear the voice of God. Let the authority of God's word stop you in your tracks and get your attention. You need to listen to the voice of God. Listen, if you really need to hear an audible voice of God, tomorrow morning when you get up, open up this book and read it out loud and listen to it. Listen to the voice of God. Let it get your attention. You see, all of our insecurities, all of our doubts, and all of our fears, they're always going to tell you to run from every challenging situation. But you need to stop and listen to the voice of God and see what God's telling you. Sometimes God's going to tell you some stuff that you're not going to feel too keen on. I can just presume that Moses, being the wilderness man that he was, that maybe he was more apropos to pick up a snake than I would have been. God would have had, I had a tough time in this burning bush. God probably would have had to start another bush on fire on down the road in the path that I was running. But somehow Moses stopped and he heard the voice of God, and God said, pick it up. I don't know if I'd have heard the voice of God. I'd still been too busy rebuking the serpent. You know, in Jesus' name, get out of here. Let me just tell you more about my philosophy on snakes. You didn't come for this, but I'm going to tell you anyway, since they still got me mic'd up. The reality is, if I've got to handle a snake and I don't have my shovel, I'm still not going to pick that snake up by the tail. No. Some of you understand what I'm talking about. If you're really going to pick up one, you got to ease up and you got to pick up that booger from behind the head. Because if you pick him up by the tail, guess what he's going to do? He's going to turn right around. He's going to... real quick, like, he's going to get you. But God said, I want you to pick him up by the tail, Moses. What's going on with this? Why did God tell Moses, pick this snake up? Well, because Moses needed to understand the one that you're talking to, the one that's calling you into this ministry, the one who sees the potential in your life and has purpose beyond your wildest imagination for your life, you need to understand he has got the power over all of the powers that are in existence. He is El Shaddai. He is God Almighty. His power is greater than all the power of the enemy, all the power of Pharaoh, all the power of the Egyptian court, all that false magic, all them false ideologies. God says, I'm above it all. You need to be able to reach down and understand when you pick up that thing. Now, you've got to understand something. Moses did not understand that God was going to immediately transform this snake back into a staff. No, friend, he's just reaching out by obedience. Obedience is better than sacrifice. Moses had made some sacrifices in his life. Moses had a great education. Man, what in the world is he doing out here keeping livestock? Wasting his life away, putting up with a bunch of four-footed, oh, dumb creatures. What's he doing? He's just doing everything he knows how to do. But in the midst of making all those sacrifices, some of y'all made some sacrifices for God too. But church, all of our sacrifices are meaningless unless we obey the voice of God. The fourth R about how you can start a revolution is for you to reach out for obedience. Reach for obedience in the call of God upon your life. God's calling you. God's speaking to you. You need to reach out your hand and take back that which you gave to God. When God calls you and God tells you to go, when God tells you to speak to people about the Lord, when God says, hey, I need you to witness to this one and tell them it ain't got to be that way. They ain't got to stay in need. Friend, go ahead. Use what God has given you. Use what's at your hand, what's in your hand. You see, you've got potential in your hand. You need to understand the one that's called you has a destiny for your life. It may not be just the humdrum of regular life, but I promise you, God wants to use you regardless of where you're at. What you're doing. You need to hear the voice of God today. He wants to use you to start a revolution. In closing, I would counsel you to remember something that I personally feel like we modern day charismatics and Pentecostals have gotten carried away with. Friend, you don't have a ministry. I don't have a ministry. I don't have an anointing. Blows your mind, don't it? It's all about perspective. God has a ministry. I have a destiny. I have a purpose. I have some gifts that God placed in me. But it's really His ministry. I'm just a servant of the Master and His ministry. I don't have an anointing. No, I serve the Anointed One. You see, it's not mine. It's His. Could we just remind ourselves this morning that we're servants of God? We're all children of God. We're all servants of God. I don't own this calling. I don't own this anointing. Every Sunday before I step out of here, most Sundays of the year, I pray something similar to this. Jesus, I know I'm not anointed, but You are the Anointed One. And for these next few moments, as I step into the spoken ministry that You've called me to, and as I go out here to speak to Your people, Lord, with the message that You've deposited into my heart, Jesus, I pray that You just place Your hands upon me. Could I borrow of the anointing of the Anointed One for the next few minutes that I could accomplish the work? You see, that's all that took place for Moses. The Anointed One spoke to him and anointed him to go and do the work. Did that mean that Moses was always perfect and Moses would never make a mistake again in his life or ministry? No. He made a few mistakes. Did it mean that life was always going to be peaceful and easy and peace, man? No. No, sometimes the people he loved the most come against him the worst. He had to pastor a large church that was filled with whiners, grumblers, complainers. God bless him. All it really meant is that he could do what God called him to do. In these closing moments, I want to tell you something straightforward. Stop focusing on what you can't do. Believe what God says you can do. Stand with me as we try to close today. Moses was just a human instrument in the hands of an almighty God. God, though, wanted to use Moses to start a revolution, otherwise known as deliverance. There are people in your life, people in your work life, in your student life. There are people in your world who need you to start a revolution. Man, you got to get on board with it. You see, in spite of the failures of his past, Moses couldn't change them. The failures of his past were still there, but God still called him. You can't change the failures of your past. I can't change anything that happened yesterday or 2019 or over the last decade. But what I can do is make up my mind that I'm going to listen to the voice of God, and I'm going to be obedient to His Spirit, and I'm going to step out by faith and start a revolution. You see, this call of God was that they may believe. Did you see that in Exodus chapter 4 there? Why is God doing all this? Why such a significant experience of sanctification for the call of God upon Moses? That they may believe. God wants to use you. He has the same purpose in mind for your life, to help others believe in the Lord God Almighty. Are you ready to step out in faith? Are you ready to trust the God of heaven and earth, who has all power in heaven and earth, who wants to save you, who wants to sanctify, who wants to reclaim us and heal us of our backslidings? Are you ready to step out in faith and be a revolutionary? You say you want a revolution. Well, you need to understand something. God's placed something inside of you. There's potential in you. There's a purpose for your life. God knows exactly the place where you are, and He wants to use you. What's that you have in your hand? God says, I can use it if you're willing to lose it. Take the little you have, place it at His disposal, and He'll use you to start a revolution. With heads bowed and eyes closed, I ask you, my friend, are you in a right relationship with God today? Are you ready to believe in Him, place your faith in Him, and start walking by faith? If my prayer team would come, get ready to pray with individuals. I look to you in this congregation with heads bowed and eyes closed for the next couple of moments. Please be sensitive to what the Spirit of God is doing. Friend, are you in a right place with God? Are you ready to go to heaven? Well, yeah, I'm ready to go, preacher. I want to go, but really, are you ready? You see, there's a thing that stops us from being really ready, and it's called sin. Some of us, have even sinned against ourselves, not just against others and against God, but we've sinned against ourselves, and we won't even let loose of the sins of the past. We refuse to forgive ourselves, even after God has said, I forgive you, I release you. And he's covered it with the shed blood of Jesus Christ. I'm talking to somebody here today. Friend, who makes you greater than God? Forgive yourself. If God's forgiven you, if God's forgotten it, you need to choose to stop remembering it. Accept that you've been forgiven. We're going to sing, we're going to praise, and we're going to pray. Whether you need to get right with God for the first time, or you need to come to God and ask him to forgive you for your backslidings, and you want to recommit to Christ today, this invitation is for you. Maybe you're here today, you say, sure, Pastor, I'm a believer. I've been to that altar before. Are you truly sanctified? I know that's a word you don't hear very much, but that word means that not only you know you're forgiven and you know God and you're in a relationship with him, but you've been set apart and you understand there's a calling upon my life. That's what happened for Moses there in Exodus chapters 3 and 4. He got sanctified in the holy presence of God Almighty. Maybe you need to pray that prayer today as a Christian. God, sanctify me, cleanse me, make me holy so that I can accomplish the purpose of my life that you've called me to. Let us pray. Praise the Lord. This invitation is for you. Let us pray today.
You're worthy of every song we could ever sing. You're worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath. Jesus' name.
prayer. I don't know what your need is today. And I don't want to impose anything upon you. But if the Lord has touched your heart today and there's something you need to talk to him about, whether you do it down here or where you're at, maybe you just reach out to the person next to you and say, believe God with me for just a moment. And you lift it up to God in prayer, believing that he sees your heart. He knows the things you have need of before you even ask him. If you'll believe him today and you'll do business with heaven with what he's doing business with your soul about, I believe there'll be a marvelous transaction. I believe that every prayer request in the house of God today is but a praise report in the making. Let's worship him. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus. Lord.
God want to use you to help to deliver someone from bondage. He want to use you this year. He want to use you this month. I want to encourage you to step out in faith and let God use you this year. Amen. If you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, or you rededicated your life to the Lord, we want to hear about it. Please indicate on your connect card. If you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and your Savior, you want to know what's next? What's next is come and be baptized next Sunday. The Bible says repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus. So if you accepted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, your next step is to be baptized. Next Sunday, we will be baptizing here at Harvest Christian Center. And you want to be included, please come on Wednesday. Wednesday during our 7 o'clock service, we have a baptism class that lets you know what the Bible says, what to expect in baptism, and what the Bible says and why we baptize. I want to encourage you, if you accepted the Lord, if you haven't been baptized, do not delay. Amen. The first of the year is a good time to reprioritize, put the first things first. Amen. Prioritize your life. One other announcement. Tonight, this evening at 5 p.m., we have church-wide prayer. I want everybody to repeat after me. Repeat, church-wide. Amen. Church-wide prayer. I want to see all of you tonight in prayer. It's the first of the year. We're praying for our direction for Harvest and what God wants to have us to do. So please be here. Meet us at 5 p.m. for church-wide prayer. I expect all the leadership team to be here. But we pray for direction for 2020. Amen. If all hearts and minds are clear, let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the hearts that have been changed, burdens that have been lifted, yokes that have been broken in this service. Lord, we thank you for those that will step out in faith to be used by you in this new year. Lord, we pray that you continue to stir up your gift that is within them, God. Direct their steps, direct their mind, God. Those that will redirect their thoughts to you in this season and through fasting and prayer, Lord, we pray that you strengthen them. Encourage their hearts. Lord, I ask you to let your spirit be with each and every family represented here until we meet again. Protect them, direct them, encourage them. In Jesus' name we pray. Let everyone say amen and amen. You are dismissed.